the Savannah River site, the Los Alamos National Laboratory. Several of these, what they used to call them, uranium feed mills, Mallinckrodt, etc., and that the dosimetry at all these sites were wildly different. The philosophy of radiation protection were wildly different. The Oak Ridge Y-12 plant was running it like a heavy metal foundry and didn't care, didn't even bother to measure anybody for radiation until 1960. We found a real hodgepodge. And so I tend to agree with Ian here about this business of dose, individual dose in particular, is that it's ephemeral. And that when we think about the, and oh, the other thing is the politics, is that why was it the government suddenly became so generous with nuclear weapons workers when at least a year before they would blink an eye to spend $1 million to drive a widow into bankruptcy for arguing for a worker comp claim before a state court, because the politics were, well, if we grant compensation, this is a dagger aimed at our heart, at the heart of our national security. This ended when the Cold War ended. And that was another factor we had to take into account. So I think this is a much more complicated game here that we're dealing with here. We're dealing with how do you blend social justice with science is a very important one. Things cannot be strictly, there is no such thing when you get into this business, as been pointed out, as scientific exactitude. It just is not there. And that it takes, quite frankly, I think, why did we grant this law? Why did we get this law passed? Why was it that the Republicans in the Congress at the time were even far more generous than we yellow dog Democrats? It's because there were angry workers and angry widows who had banded together and were every time any elected official, any official who showed up, who were making decisions on their behalf, they got in their face. The same thing with atomic veterans, the same thing with Don Winders, the same thing with uranium miners. The politics of this cannot be underestimated and should not be dismissed.
Next question is for you, and I guess it's somewhat, maybe it will allow you to address the question about access to information from these positions of power to do these studies, but how did you get data on cancer and deaths after Three Mile Island? I thought all victims signed a gag clause, and specifically a film, TMI Revisited, claimed that there were 250,000 excess deaths, including many miles downwind. I guess what would be your comment on sort of access to this information and these numbers?
So the information on the map that I showed earlier is not about cancer deaths, it's about cancer cases, incidence, morbidity, the occurrence of diagnosed cancers. They were ascertained from 15 hospitals in the catchment area for that part of the country. So the records had to be abstracted from each hospital one at a time. That work was done by a group right here in New York City at Columbia University. We obtained the information through a court order. When we were reanalyzing the data, which we were asked to do by plaintiffs by lawyers representing the plaintiffs who claimed damages from radiation exposure. And I have also heard that some people have signed, settlements were made with them, that they signed away their rights to speak publicly about what happened to them, but I don't really have any more information than that.